for being part of the Cyclops Nation this season. And fans, if you want to be part of the Cyclops next season, head over to Fan Services now. If your Frisbee number matches the first Cyclops goal scorer's number, you'll be going home with a Cyclops t-shirt. We ask that you please return all Frisbees by the end of the game. So come on, fans, if you want a Frisbee, make some noise! The winner will be going home with a Cyclops hoodie and will be announced during the fourth quarter. Head on over to the concourse now and start making your Thank you. and welcome our dear friend, Ethan Golden, again, who has come many times for his calls against juvenile arthritis. Bring Ethan your blind on the golf course during the game. Fans, in the interest of your safety, please be aware that the crossballs and other objects may fly into the spectator area and can be.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome back inside the C-Lax Community Center here in Paris, Ontario. Matthew Carrick back alongside all of our JVI Sports Network crew. We've been in the house all day. It's been a bit of a long one for us, as this is our fifth game out of five here on Super Saturday. There's a look at your officials who will call the pro game here this evening. Crew Chief Grant Spies, along with Joel Furman, the technical official Neil McDonald, and the 30-second clock will be operated by Jacob Singleton. It is the Southwest Cyclops versus the Durham Turfdogs. Durham comes in with 10 points. They do have two games left to play. They'll be in Barrie tomorrow afternoon. That game at 2 p.m. Eastern time start on C-Lax TV once again. Niagara Lock Monsters will play the Southwest Cyclops at the same time. Again, you can check both those games out. If you're in the area, come on down and check out the game live, both at the Meridian Center and the Barrie Molson Center, or you can check our webcast as well. Heading into the final week of games here, as the Durham Turf Dogs, they can win twice and have a statistical tie with the Lock Monsters should the Lock Monsters beat Southwest tomorrow. And then those would be the first two seeds as we go into the semifinal weekend coming up next week. Got a couple players who we're going to keep our eye on. Three per side here in this game this afternoon, or this evening, I should say. We'll start on the side of the Southwest Cyclops as they look to Jordan Dance, Patrick Corbett, and Dan Keane. Not a lot out of Dan Keane so far this season. Not as much as we saw last year when he was part of the all-rookie team. But Jordan Dance has led the way since returning, and watch for Patrick Corbett at the faceoff dot. On the other side of things, we look to Tim Bergen, who's back in the lineup. He'll quarterback the power play most likely. Down on the crease, they'll go with Dylan Goddard, who's a big shooter. They're missing a lot of guys, including John St. John and Jesse Guerin, who's still out. Matt Croak, Derek Hopcroft, Pete Rennie, and, pardon me, Thomas Hogarth have both been called up to the NLL. And finally, Jeff McNulty will be in on the crease as well. Our starting goaltender for tonight's game will start from the visitors on the side of the Durham Turf Dogs. Number 44, Cole Murray, has been fantastic all season long in what's been mostly a backup role, but when he's been called into action, again, he has had pretty huge games. It will be interesting what they do in tomorrow's game, the one that they need to win, whether they go back to Ryan Masters. Lucas Coote has been fairly consistent as well, but Cole Murray, as we said, getting the start here this evening inside the C-Lax Community Center. We go to the other side of the floor now, and we look at the starting goaltender for the Southwest Cyclops. Grant Crawley will back up Craig Wendy, who has been around for a little bit here and there over the last couple years, one of the hardest working goaltenders without a full-time job pretty much in Ontario lacrosse, as he's been at every single tryout and training camp and everything else. He gets the start here this evening in the final game of the season for the Southwest Cyclops. They have been mathematically eliminated from the playoffs, looking to play spoiler against the Durham Turf Dogs.
At 8 years old, Ethan Golden, who lives every day with juvenile arthritis, but he doesn't let that stop him. It was very early in his diagnosis that he decided that no one should have to live in pain like he does, and he pledged a very lofty goal of raising $1 million for juvenile arthritis research. first year started slow, but he raised about 27,000 dimes over the year. In June 2014, he decided to have a lemonade stand. That's when things started to really take off. In one day, he doubled his dime total, raising over 30,000 dimes in one day. In July 2014, his dime total was 69,707. Today, his total has rocketed to 440,000 dimes, over $44,000. Ethan also had a very exciting 2015. He was named Junior Philanthropist of the Year by the Association of Fundraising Professionals. He threw out the first pitch for the Toronto Blue Jays during their July home game. He was named the Brantford Community Hero. His annual lemonade stand raised $10,010 in just 6 hours. Ethan's older brother Jeremiah is autistic and also has juvenile arthritis. Even though Ethan is a younger brother, he helps Jeremiah find the words to describe how he feels. He helps by bringing comfort and a deeper understanding to Jeremiah's arthritis pain. Ethan is a rock star. He's motivated to do good through good, and even at this young age, understands what hard work is, how to set goals, and take steps to achieve them. One more time, fans, let's hear it for our very own Ethan.
And we are just about set for game action. Our fifth game of the day here on C-Lax TV. Reminder to go to CanadianLacrosseLeague.com where you can catch this game and then again two games tomorrow, including the live stat updates as they happen here in Paris. Before the game, Ethan Goodwin, founder of Ethan's Dimes, fantastic young man, has raised over 400,000 dimes, $40,000. His goal is 1,000,000 dimes, all in support of juvenile arthritis. And they had the dimes counter out front. $10,000, not dimes, dollars, from a lemonade stand this summer in just over 6 hours, with all the proceeds going to juvenile arthritis. A great start to what is our final game of the season here inside the C-Lax Community Center, Matthew Carrick, alongside our JVI Sports Network crew, as we bring you the beginning of the end of the regular season. Game number 1 of 3 in week number 8. As we got a back over call here. Durham Turfdogs are the visitors. They're in their green uniform, double green, as they've got the dark green numbers. Red and yellowy lime for the home side, Southwest Cyclops. They'll work left to right here in the opening period. Balls continue to just bounce around here in the opening period. Jordan Dance will lift it over to Dan Keene as Cyclops try and get their first offensive set. Nice slide over there made by Rob Clofer, as it looked like Dance was wide open on the crease, but the trailer on the play, Martin Whitaker lines up the shot, and Cole Murray has his first major test of the game out of the way. Gage board to the far side, the low sub shot there, rattles off the backboards. Picked up by Dance, he's looking for the crease man, it's Whitaker, as Whitaker goes in for the loose ball. 12 in the shot clock as Whitaker takes another one that Cole Murray saves. Right in front of the Turfdog bench here, Clofer's lost his stick as the ball just bounces to Mike Triolo back in the lineup after a brief injury hiatus. There's a big bump there from Nevin Sullivan. Drawing the ball free, it goes deep down. Craig Wendy in there trying to dig for it. Brett Olbikas as well for Southwest. Gage board involved. Part of the triple team is now working out is Whitaker, and the bump from Keene right over the top of Wendy. This is gonna draw a crowd and have whistles. Fireworks already inside the C-Lax Community Center. We're just outside of 2 minutes gone here in period number one. Wendy will get up and clear out of the way. We'll see if anything comes to either Rob Clofer or Dan Keene, as it looked like Keene had bumped Clofer into the net. Looks like Clofer heading off here. Dan Keene also walking slowly. There's another look at what happened as they work out of the corner. See if there was contact with Keene. Oh, a little bit, but Clofer, I don't think, did a whole ton of a lot to get out of the way there either. Trying to stop things before they start. For the officiating crew, again led by Grant Spies, the crew chief here this evening. Cole Murray with another save as the ball works down the far side by Mark Farthing, still on Durham's shot clock, so they call over and back. If you've been with us all day long, our press box located right over top of the benches. The outside shot from Jordan Dance goes off Cole Murray, up and out of play. We do have an effects mic to pick up the ambient noise and the crowd cheering and et cetera, but from time to time you may hear something you probably shouldn't from those guys underneath of us, and we apologize for that in advance if and when it does happen. Spencer Pike takes a shot that Cole Murray saves. Dance from up top, over the shoulder for Pike again. They play catch here up top as now they go in the star pattern down to Keene, who had taken up the crease spot. Took the shot, Murray again with the save. And this game still looking for its opening goal as the goalies are gonna play catch now. 40 seconds remains in the power play. Here's Spencer Pike. Remained on after a brief change. Patrick Corbett, one of our players to watch for Southwest, fired that one towards the net. Comes back for Gageboard. That one off a body before going into the corner. Joel Furman calls for interference. Up top for Dance with a fresh 30. Should do it for the power play with 20 seconds remaining in that. 18 on the shot clock now as Dance gives for Keene, who rips. And off of Cole Murray, up out of play one more time as Dance now has a check for the clock. Another 30 seconds is Pike to Dance to Keene. Here's Dance. Back down in the corner. Pike had switched with Gage Board over to the far side. Quickly back into the fray. A couple chops there as they play for the loose ball. And it's going to be picked up by Nevin Sullivan. He gets drilled as he gets to center floor. Sullivan and Gage Board still in battle as Patrick Corbett goes after this loose ball. Picked up by Durham and then shoved down like from behind by Spencer Pike. It will be Durham ball as Gage Board was ready to run away with it. Another bump. That's a few from behind already. Still yet to see our first penalty. Josh Wasson goes to the far side. Vredenberg slips as he took that shot and gets up. It's a bit of a limp in the step, it looks like, as Josh's brother Joe Wasson can't come up with a loose ball. That allows Dan Keene to come away with it. Keene falling as he tried to shoot. That forced it to go wide. It's played back over center now. Reed Board down into the corner. Looking dive shot and goal. Oh, what a goal there from Patrick Corbett. Again, one of our players to watch. As Corbett out of the corner came through with the diving shot. And that's our first goal of the game. Joel Furman had a great look and he signals goal. Candidate for our play of the game comes on our very first goal, a beautiful one from Patrick Corbett. Oh, a big collision there. Mike Triolo goes for a ride as he was down on the turf. Braden Curran. Gonna bring up Graham Bergsma picking up the assist. On that goal. As now Travis Zubolks through the middle, late man off the bench. Zubolks is gonna get the goal. Ryan McCrory picks up at least one of the assists as he passed away. Passed the ball away, I probably should say. To start that attack, heading to the bench. No one picks up Zubolks as he comes off the bench again, going straight to the net. We go back to the faceoff dot. Just like that, nodded at once. And another one in transition. They had Brandon Armstrong running the length of the floor, doing most of the work. Maybe Riley Campbell. Not sure who that was. As we'll have to see here on the replay. This is Armstrong doing most of the work. He finds a cutter straight through and then trailer and again more contact in on Wendy. Face-off win for Corbett. Campbell and Armstrong picking up the assists. It is now 2-1 in favor of Durham. As Matt Spanger slides over and gives Ryan McCrory a bit of a knock. Tim Bergen off the bench now. He goes to the half boards. Drag of the foot for Josh Wasson. Far side, Vredenberg now. He's gonna return it all the way over. Big pick from Bergen, trying to give space for the big man, Mike Triolo. You can see six on the clock as Bergen takes the shot. Oh, and one up high as well. Bucket goes flying. And we'll see if someone's going off here. Looks like jogging to the bench is Reed Board. As a word for Joel Furman as well. It will indeed be high sticking. As we'll see play right here. 5 minute major straight to the bucket. As the Southwest bench not happy with that. 8 minutes left in quarter number one. Spanger on Triolo. Those are two real tall athletic bodies. They go up top, sidearm shot. Now Cody McMahon gets it through. Sneaking out the back door was Matt Spanger, though, and he had to climb the ladder in the pass just out of his reach. Coming from Craig Wendy. Down over center, McMahon. Josh Wasson, he goes down to the crease. They give back for Zabolks, will take the shooter spot. McNulty on that side. Back for Wasson again. Over his shoulder, McNulty scores. Another look at it here. A ton of ball movement on this power play set. It's going to be the top two guys, McMahon and Zabolks, it looks like, picking up assists. Already 2 points in the game for Zabolks. A goal and an assist now, as there's a huge collision in front of the timekeeper's box. Ball brought out by Connor Daly, a man who may hold the record for playing the most, for the most number of teams. We've seen this a couple times today as Jake Kranz slips and falls. It is a slippery surface, very spongy carpet, but it's got a slip to it as well. As Kranz fell, now he goes back after the ball. Pass gets away just before the stick check does. And Cody McMahon back for Bergen. Him and McMahon play catch. Switching with McNulty now, here's Bergen. Over to the far side, Goddard down to the crease. That's where McNulty has eventually ended up. Shot comes from Goddard off the backboards. In front of the net, McMahon, oh, what a save from Wendy. Maybe that'll get him in the game. The left hand popping out, pushing the rebound into the corner. First one there is Graham Bergsma. He immediately looks up floor. What a reception made there. And we're gonna get a late whistle. And we'll see what the call is here. Two for illegal cross-checking against Durham, and Southwest picks up a bench minor for unsportsmanlike conduct. And that's the huge save from Craig Wendy. So now we've got two candidates for play of the game, as that save may make it as well. Player down over the top into the bucket is the cross-checking play. And now they're trying to determine who has the ball and where it goes. 6:15 on the clock. Officials timeout is called on the floor. They'll take a quick break. We'll do the same. And we'll try and sort it out. What we do know, Durham Turfdogs, pardon me, Southwest Cyclops, will be in penalty shot territory. There's a major on the board against them. Scores 3-1 in the final game here in Paris for the 2016 season. We'll step aside. You're watching C-Lax action on C-Lax TV 1. A physical game inside the C-Lax Community Center, including some big hits already in this one. There's a big one. We've had a few pretty big penalties called as well, including a 5-minute major for high sticking. As we watch more of this huge body contact, that one I believe went for a penalty for checking from behind off this most recent play. We do have a cross-checking minor against the Durham Turf Dogs. We also have a bench minor for unsportsmanlike conduct against the Southwest Cyclops. They still have 3 minutes on the board remaining in their major penalty. And it looks like they're going to end up with the ball here, as they had the ball. Offsetting penalties will keep them the ball, as it'll be 4-on-3 floor strength in favor of the Durham Turfdogs. It'll be Keane down into the corner. Keane again, he tries to dive across one more time, plays his own rebound. Oh, over the shoulder. Save made, positional save from Cole Murray. There's no way he saw that ball arriving on scene. Here's Mark Farthing. Farthing's gonna flip for Josh Wasson. Wasson into the corner. Up top, Jeff McNulty now. Plays it into the far corner for Wasson for Sebulks. Sidearm shot, looking between the legs of Wendy. Slams the wickets closed. Wasson and Spanger look to collide, and it's Sabolks coming over to take the bigger body of Spanger away. Still got over the time and restraining line as Patrick Corbett took a bump there from Sabolks. We're gonna have a high sticking call, it looks like. And the bench of the Turf Dogs doesn't like that penalty. 3-on-3, next penalty will be a penalty shot, and you can judge for yourself here. We will slow it down. Does the stick get a little bit high right here as it tries to cut through? I don't know. Dance trying the one-time shot for Dan Keane. Mark Farthing on his horse, one of the best transition players in the history of this league. Oh, turned the shoulder, couldn't release, was waiting for Clofer to get in position, and he's got to sprint back 200 feet. As he goes back after Jordan Dance, who takes that shot. And gasping for air is Mark Farthing after two 200-foot sprints. Dance with the ball now. He gets pushed down to the carpet. A couple big chops there. Interference against the Turf Dog player. Pardon me, against the Cyclops player. It will be Turf Dog's ball, just left in the corner by Joel Furman. He lets Mark Vredenberg get there as the offsetting miners are 5 seconds away from expiring. Bench getting another warning here, it looked like, as the officials, I don't want to say afraid to call the penalty shot, but very reluctant to do so. As early days of this league and early days of the season, we usually see that called. Not so much in the final game of regular season. Of course, this is a spot where guys don't necessarily care about any discipline in the final game. This ball works into the corner for Southwest. Patton off the bench, getting himself into the fray. Shot comes here from Martin Whitaker. It's played up by Dylan Goddard. Goddard racing it over the shoulder, stepped in the crease though. Not sure where that one ends up. It's in the far corner. Picked up here by Southwest. Spencer Pike goes to the far side as the door opens and McNulty rejoins the floor. As we're finally back to 5-on-5. You can see that's a lot of room that has just been closed up as Pike collides in with Ryan McCrory. McCrory trying to come straight through center as he takes a big bump. Durham bench wants a holding call, as you can hear, none upcoming. Here's McNulty. He's trying to go, looked like for Brandon Armstrong or Clofer on the far side. As Triolo coming down right tight to the crease, a little too close for the liking of Grant Spies. Crease violation called. Cyclops get the ball, about 3 minutes remain here in quarter number one, 2.5 to be exact. Here's Jordan Dance. Dance for Board, they come in, the shot and a goal. Looks like Braden Curran working in on net. Started outside. Get it down low, Curran, the shot and the goal. He gets in. Here comes Triolo. Matched with Graham Bergsma, a former Durham Turf Dog. Was out of the country for work for a couple years. Was traded from the Turf Dogs to the Lock Monsters, and then from the Lock Monsters to the Cyclops. Graham Bergsma made his return to C-Lax earlier this year. Here's Dance, takes a couple whacks from Campbell. They play it down low. Now Dance cutting to the net. Cole Murray sends that one aside. The near boards right in front of the Durham bench. Actually is Brett Obikas. Here's Jordan Dance. Just getting away from Riley Campbell, who's trying to take him into the boards. Up top they go for Whitaker. That's a huge shot there from Ryan McCroy. Spinning around is Whitaker again. Right in front, got the shot away, but not before the foot touchdown in the crease. 90 seconds left to play in quarter number one. Travis Zabolz up over center. McNulty. Far side, Vredenberg. He gives back for McNulty. Tim Bergen is cut to the net. Zabolz takes the shot. Bergen trying to grab for it. Huge collision. And as one of the Turf Dogs hits the deck, he's underneath the entire pile. It may be Vredenberg down there, either him or McNulty. Comes out, Vredenberg is giving chase as the ball carries on the far side. We're in the final minute of play here in period number one. Up ahead, Gage Board over to the far side. Dan Keane will set a pick for Jordan Dance. Dance tries to skip a shot. Very spongy surface, picked out of the crease though as the rebound sat there. Played in and a goal. Zach Sloan. There from Braden Curran. So now I'll give it to the Durham Turf Dogs for the final 28 seconds. Cole Murray slowly jogging his way up to the bench. And now he does take his seat. Extra attacker is on. It's Mark Vredenberg. 17 seconds, now 16 on the game clock. 3 second difference between that and the shot clock. Back for Bergen. Over the top, you can see a couple seconds remains on the shot clock. Picked up in the corner though. And Graham Bergsma can't get a shot away before time expires. And it will end the first quarter, knotted at threes. 15 in the books here on the final game of the season for the Southwest Cyclops. As we start the final weekend of regular season play. It is week number 8 here in the Canadian Lacrosse League. We'll take a time out. You're watching C-Lax action on C-Lax TV 1.
Thank you.
Southwest Cyclops Bull, swarm number 44, Spencer Pike. Assisted by number 77, Van Veen, and number 79, Brian.
We apologize for what we believe was audio issues there. We're a minute and 10 seconds into period number one. Huge hit there, Jordan Gantz. Pops up as he tries to get the ball away now from Patrick McCrory. Maybe a little high, no arms go up. As we did miss a goal there from Southwest to start period number one. As this will be an over and back now against the Southwest Cyclops. Or will it?
No!
Joel Furman saying the ball was tipped. As he comes up, you can hear. Durham Turf Dog bench. Well, he does not like that call. And it'll be a draw ball at center. So a bit of a weird one there. As should remind you that teams have switched sides here for quarter number two. Southwest home side will go right to left. Cole Murray still in the net. To our right as Matt Spanger now circles him. Hustling up the far side. Spanger straight through the middle. Passes to the near side now where Graham Bergsman is waiting. Far corner. Comes back for Kranz. The long locks flowing out from under the bucket of Jake Kranz. Him and Elijah Printup fighting over who's got best hair in C-Lax. Now that Dylan Lord is gone, he had the perm there for a while, Dylan Lord did, as Wendy lifts it up and running underneath is Britton Curran. Curran pushes it outside, Martin Whitaker up top. Curran heading up as they change one man. Trying to pass, looking through the cutter, and that one will go for over and back. Great seat here where we can hear every conversation. The bench telling Joel Furman that must have been tipped as well. Here's McCrory. Back to the far side. Jeff McNulty now dancing around. Passes it down low. McRory up top, another shot. All the left hand of Wendy had to go back behind him. Where's the ball as they look to find it? Got stuck in the pants. As Keane will bring up over center. And Keane left for Reed Board. Into the half boards now. Far side. It's returned back again. Patrick Corbett bounces that one wide off the boards. Shot comes about three-quarter angle from gauge board. Cole Murray did go down, made the save, and now it's brought up over center. Riley Campbell, bright yellow sneakers. Lime green, maybe. It's a duck and a drive and stripped out the back door. As he come right underneath of us, Patrick Corbett looking to go to goal, and now he passes off as Gage Board is over there. Gage Board over the top. Goes for Spanger down into the corner. Cyclops on a change as they give for Blair Goss. He goes to the far boards. Far side looking for a low blast. Gets through the crowd. Cole Murray makes the save, however, as there's 10 and a half to play in half. First half, Cody McMahon. Bit of a twist in that shot at the last minute. puts it through. That goal that we did miss was Spencer Pike from Dan Keenan and Brendan Kern. As we get another look at things here, started by Cole Murray doing his best Lucas Coote impression, as Coote, the first goaltender to win Transition Player of the Week award in the Canadian Lacrosse League. Still waiting for our first official goalie goal, though, in C-Lax. Of an aggressive shove there on Matt Spenger. No call for the illegal pick. As it works out of the corner, Vredenberg, the only one that wanted the loose ball, and Wendy, full splits, making the save. All the way down the floor, though, Spanger, he gets in on Murray, and Murray comes up with a big save of his own. Here's Spanger. Spanger's gonna drag it through, takes the shot. Murray with the save. Here comes Kranz. Vredenberg all over Kranz, and now Riley Campbell in to help out. Also is Braden Curran. Dan Keene just bumps into the pile. Everyone falls down, and no call, as it was the 9-foot rule as McMahon went into Keene. Kranz very lackadaisical picking up the ball to start as McMahon is fired up. Went right into his man, then took a shot. Here's Patton. The whole pile now goes down. McMahon's been trying to stir something up the entire time he's been on the floor. And Grant Spies is gonna take both of them, Martin Whitaker and Cody McMahon, as McMahon was the only thing, he wasn't asking for a penalty, as he just didn't put it in writing the whole time he was out on the floor that time. You'll see just to the left of the screen, I think the whole pile goes down. McMahon's on the top, and they stirred it up afterwards, so both of them will go, and that should be the end of the extracurriculars. Won't be the end of the scoring, though, as a shot and a goal comes from Dylan Goddard, one of our players to watch here on the afternoon. First we've heard of him, though, on the 4-on-4. Minutes for roughing was the offsetting penalties. As that may have actually been Patrick McCrory on the goal. Him and Bergsmo go head to head. Former Turf Dog in the Cyclops jersey. Former Cyclops in the Turf Dog jersey. Face-off still up for grabs on the far side. And finally, Turf Dog player picks it up. One of the Turf Dogs hit the floor there, and we've got a delayed penalty, and it'll be a holding call against Connor Daly. He disagrees. As Jake Kranz looks like he's having an issue with the ankle now. He's had a holder interference, didn't quite catch the second call from Joel Furman. Here's Dylan Goddard now. 4-on-3 power play. Southwest back to penalty shot territory. I have a feeling we might see one in this game, as we've seen a number of penalties called on both sides. Goddard down low. McNulty on the crease. And where's the ball? Again, caught up in the equipment of Craig Wendy. As Graham Bergsma looking front door. Corbett couldn't get there in time. Ball rolls free. Cole Murray to pick it out from behind his own net. Over center, here comes Goddard. Still 4-on-3 for the next 45 seconds. Goddard, far side for Bergen. Tim Bergen over the shoulder, and the shot from Wasson, they score. Lawson, it should be from Bergen and Goddard. As you can see the ball movement, but it's this pass right, whoop, right there. Down on the crease, Lawson knows the check is coming. And Stephen Stamp said it last week. A couple years ago, he was one of the best at playing down low, right tight to the crease. And every now and again, he shows even more brilliance. Peterborough Laker in major series. Here comes Matt Spanger down, takes the shot, bounces off. Looked like the toe cap may have hit one of the lights here. It's a very high ceiling at the C-Lax Community Center. Make room for the meeting room upstairs in the far end to our right. As Dan Keene puts the brakes on, checks for the clock. 7 minutes remain on it. 3 seconds until the offsetting minors expire. As the shot comes in, and it's high over the net from Brett Ulbikas. McRory up close to center floor. Brother Ryan is racing in, shoots and scores. That most recent Durham goal, McNulty was the only one credited with an assist, as I think Bergen should get one as well. As it's just a twister shot, Patrick from Ryan. As Corbett off the faceoff dot coming in on net, takes the shot, a save. And a ton of whistles here. I think they've realized finally that we need to take the officials' time out. We'll do the same as they take care of business inside the C-Lax Community Center. Matthew Carrick, our JVI Sports Network crew. Officials' time out of the second quarter in what's been a rough and fast-paced game. Final one from C-Lax as we start week number 8 of the Canadian Lacrosse League. Pretty good goaltending performances here tonight as well. Good focusing a lot on the physical play, but how about this one from Craig Wendy? A guy who doesn't get much play time in behind Grant Crawley and Don Alton. Both of them in the house. As it'll be autograph night on the floor after the game. If you're in Barrie or Niagara, they'll do the same at both of those arenas as they've been making the tour, fan appreciation nights, at all final home games. Cole Murray, Goddard ran the length of the floor as they used McMahon as a decoy. Now Goddard gets up over center. Huge pick there, Triolo dropping Corbett. Former Toronto Beaches player against the former Burlington player. Or member of the Brooklyn Redmen or an Oakville Rock, is sent for a ride there was Gage Board, as he hit both McMahon and I think McNulty, either him or Zebokes. Got the first shot. Zebokes with the ball now as Board goes after him. Shot comes back from Vredenberg down in the corner. McNulty, let's look at the offensive movement. Off ball from the Turf Bulldogs. Sibokes takes another shot and it goes off the shoulder of Wendy and up into the screening out of play. So they'll play Back again off the change. Looking for Goddard. Switches the stick, gets away from Corbett. Another split save made from Wendy. Makes that look so easy. I'd be in hospital for 3 weeks if I tried that. Pike up for Corbett now. Corbett to the half boards. Oh, not ready for that was Patton. And Liam Patton had to reach out and save it from going over and back. Southwest player looked like he ducked into that check. As it's gonna be a delayed penalty coming against Brandon Armstrong for a high stick. The stick did get up high, but it looked like the ball carrier was stumbling in the process. So Joel Furman, not a popular man here on the floor tonight. Dipped ahead, and again, the stick did come up. And it'll be a power play here for the Southwest Cyclops. Shot from outside, skips off Cole Murray. Remained in the crease though, that was Graham Bergsma seeing power play time now. As Patrick McGrory up through center, looking for Riley Campbell, intercepted. As they overlook Patrick Corbett, running underneath that is Sullivan. And Nevin Sullivan back down the floor. He was trying to connect with Patrick McGrory, as now we've got a string of errant passes down on the floor. Spencer Pike, quarterback position on this set as it comes over, down into the corner. Cutting through, the shot comes from Gage Board, and Cole Murray went down to make the save. 4:15 on the clock before we hit halftime. 1 minute remaining in the power play here for Southwest. Farthing up over center, a huge spin move to get off his man. Farthing now gonna circle the net, still drawing the double team, trying to get away from the double team to get a reset of the shot clock. And just one man on him, that's Corbett. We'll see if they do reset here. And they do, as it hits 2 seconds. Patrick McRory, or pardon me, Ryan McRory, lost the ball though, so Corbett comes down the floor. Slide over there, comes from Clofer. Corbett forced to hang on, here's Keane. Far side, 20 seconds remains in the power play. Dance, off the post, and is it in? Yes, it is. Looks like Spencer Pike's got his second. Just before this goal, a couple seconds, you may have heard it on the effects mic, they asked the box to get tighter up top. Not sure if that was on Pike or on Dance. You can see the shuffle step from the man at the top of the box there, but it will be Spencer Pike from Jordan Dance. Dance's first points of the game. As Bergsma tries to pick up. Triolo straight over the top of his man. Bergsma running into the ball now. Bergsma still with it as he takes 3-4, now 5 bumps. Spanger trying to reach around his man. First one in was Brendan Monroe. We mistakenly said number 10 was Joe Wasson here this evening. It is Brandon Monroe wearing the Joe Wasson jersey as Vredenberg dances around in the corner. Cutting back from Vredenberg now. Draws it back, he's got a man all over the back, a couple extra shots as Spanger now comes in. And Wendy made the save, 2.5 to play here, 7-5. Durham Turf Dogs. They've got 7-5 in the building, 8-5 on the official stat sheet. And we seem to have 6, let's call that 8-5 then, as Triolo. It's in tight in scores. We're about 2 minutes away from halftime, so we'll try and sort out what the actual score is at that point. Another set that has a ton of movement for the Durham Turfdogs. This time, Mike Triolo. And it's now changed to It's now changed to 7-5, however, that has not updated. The most recent goal, big bump there from McRory. Dan Keane got dropped on the loose ball. Here's Keane, pick from Spanger, can't go around that. And as a shot comes, out of the stick of Gage Board, off the backboards. Picked up by Ryan McRory. McRory down the floor, passed actually into the feet though of Tim Bergen, as Bergen gives to McNulty. McNulty, far side up top for Patrick McRory. He finds Travis Zebels coming off the bench. Cody McMahon. McMahon looking for a cutting Zebels, and it went to McRory in behind the play. He comes back, here's the shot, reaching for it is Wendy. And a few bumps there in for McRory as he was in the vicinity. 34 seconds, we await a timeout call from either bench as they run down to the half-boards. Here's Board up top for Pike, his shot from the outside. 22 seconds as the loose ball is picked up, and there it is, the timeout call for the Southwest bench. Craig Wendy was already halfway home. Looks like all stats are now accounted for. 4-5, 6-7, 8-5 is the score as we hit 22 seconds left to play. Timeout was called by the Southwest bench. Southwest will keep it outside as they start this final set. Here's Pike. Into the corner. Played back for Keane, who spins around and fires. Cole Murray's down, picks it up and launches it the length of the floor. It's going to be just wide and way out of time. As what a first half. It goes in the books. It's an 8-5 lead here for the Durham Turf Dogs as they look for the first overall seed, bragging rights and spoiler privileges on the line for the Southwest Cyclops in their final game of the 2016 season. Game 5 of 5 here on our coverage on C-Lax TV here this afternoon. Reminder, if you want to check out any of those junior games from earlier today, you can do so by going to CanadianLacrosseLeague.com and looking for C-Lax TV 1. Watch the repeats and you'll see all our junior action from the playoffs here on Super Sunday here in Paris, home of the Southwest Cyclops on C-Lax TV. Halftime in Paris. We'll take a quick timeout and we'll be back to talk to you in about 10 minutes' time. Grab a drink, everyone, as we get set for half number 2. back inside the C-Lax Community Center here in Paris, Ontario. Only two games left on the schedule after today. Durham Turfdogs will be in Barrie to face the Barrie Blizzard tomorrow, their final game. Barrie Molson Center. Meridian Center will host the Niagara Lock Monsters and the Southwest Cyclops. Another look at our players to watch today: Jordan Dance, Patrick Corbett, and Dan Keane for the Southwest Cyclops. And the best out of all of those, Dan Keane has one assist, Jordan Dance has one assist, Patrick Corbett has one goal. Not all on the same play, mind you, but 1 point apiece for Southwest. On the Durham side of things, Dylan Goddard, Tim Bergen, and Jeff McNulty. McNulty, a power play goal, two assists. Goal and an assist for Dylan Goddard. And Tim Bergen, just the one assist that we credited him with. The official scorekeeper still has yet to correct that one. But definitely the Durham Turf Dog players to watch winning that battle, winning on the scoreboard as well. 8-5 as we enter the second half. Matthew Carrick and our JVI Sports Network crew bringing you C-Lax action here in week number 8. Game 5 of 5 on the day. We've been in the house all day long for junior C-Lax action as well. The Durham Turf Dogs representative actually winning the midget game and the prospect gold medal. So the Durham Turf Dogs having a good day inside the building here. Down heavily was one of the Southwest players. It may have been Corbett, actually, as Jordan Dance takes a shot just outside of the left hand. Saw him clutching the ankle there. We'll see if we have another look at that. I'm not sure. Can't see below us either who it was. Here's Dan Keane ripping through a maze, and Cole Murray sees that, makes the save. As the play gets pushed up the far side now. Turf Dogs in the prospect division had to go through the Barrie Blizzard roster first. That was our first game of the day. And then the Cyclops losing to the Niagara Lock Monsters in the prospect division. A fantastic midget final. But the Durham Turf Dogs won gold over the Osweakin Demons. As here's another shot, McNulty may have skimmed the outside of the crossbar. As Dance comes down, it's a 2-on-1 for Southwest. Trailer grabbing the ball there. That's Martin Whitaker, pardon me, Gage Board, as he couldn't corral it long enough. Southwest will hang on and wait for reinforcements, as this is Board. He's got Bergen on him. Gets a step and now passes away. Here's a shot from Keane off a stick. In front and away from Nevin Sullivan. Sullivan one-on-one with Keane, now trying to dive through. Towed the line though. That's Travis Sabolts. Gets it and trying to roll the ball, I think is what I'm trying to say in English. As it goes down all the way to Craig Wendy as no one was home. So Southwest gets a chance to bring it up again. Liam Patton now. Corbett back on the floor, if that indeed was him that it went off with his ankle. As Kranz, 10 on the shot clock now, as Kranz goes over the top, passes down into the corner, caught Blair Goss going the wrong way. As Goss is just gonna roll it back over his shoulder into the corner, where it will sit for Rob Clofer. Goes quickly up for Ryan McRory. McRory into the corner now as Durham gets set up. Cody McMahon, far side Triolo. Back for McMahon, McRory one more time. Triolo again, looking for shooting space. Hard up on him, pardon me, is Blair Goss. Spinning away from a check. Zach Sloan has one already in the game. As Triolo jogs back, takes the top position. Jordan Dance over top of him. Another slip down on that carpet. Comes here for Reed Board. Up over top, a big bump just before the loose ball. Spanger had a clear path to it as they collide over on the far side. 30-second violation. Ryan McRory trying to get it up for Riley Campbell. Over to the boards, Triolo. Bergen. as Durham tries to complete a change. Corbett straight into the pick of Riley Campbell, splits the stick in half. So Corbett now without a twig. Rough opening to the quarter here for Patrick Corbett as the shot finally does come in from Bergen. Wendy wakes the save. Spanger. Down on the crease, trying to reach over the top was Whitaker. And that's going to be brought down the far side. Brandon Monroe around the crease now. Plays back up top for Riley Campbell. Here's Bergen. Tim Bergen with it. Nevin Sullivan, quick touch pass down into the corner. Vredenberg takes a shot. That's off the left leg of Wendy. Over to the half boards. Vredenberg, we are 5-on-5. It looks like a power play set. The way the pressure was constant there and the way the ball was moving around for Durham. They now work back up over center. Whitaker took exception to a bump there from Ryan McCrory. There he had some words as they crossed center. But now Whitaker's gone off. Blair Goss passing to Kranz, who is his replacement. Bergsma. Five on the shot clock as they work out with it. It's actually Jordan Dance, pardon me. Off the boards again. Kranz, Bergman, and Dance. Actually, the entire line now. Back to play defense. Josh Wasson. As the Turf Dogs finish their line change, it's Goddard. Down low, shooting the shot. Looking five hole on Wendy. That was Patrick McCrory, who now collides on the ball here for Liam Patton. Patton close to the over and back line. McCrory tries to shove him. Far side has opened up though, as Bergsma with all kinds of time and space. Kranz straight to the net, took the shot. Rebound all the way up over half. Dan Keene on his horse. McMahon took the shot there and stripped from behind. Like it may have been Sloan as McCrory works over Sloan. Kranz to the far side again. Both teams made a change as they crossed their respective benches that time. Reed Board, oh, he takes a big slash right in the midsection. As it's a 2-on-1 coming down. Mark Farthing over for Goddard, back for Farthing. As Goddard was on the wrong side, couldn't get that pass away quick enough as he was being double teamed in the process. Farthing in the corner. As now there's a change developing here for Durham as it went off the wall. Matt Spanger with no one behind him. Clofer on his horse and he's gonna strip. As Rob Clofer got in there on Matt Spanger. Clofer, a hard bump for Spanger. Took exception, ran after him. This goes up for Bradenburg. Now Triolo, quick release shot. Oh, trying to go over the top now of Wendy. And a little too high. As we go end to end here. Gage Board puts the brakes on. Faking pass for Keene. Wide floor here for Southwest this time. As they work out from the half boards. It's Braden Curran. Back down low, oh, big slip there. Falling in a little bit slow getting up here is Jordan Gantz. As it ball finds its way to Cole Murray, who quickly gets up for Riley Campbell. Vredenberg the only one that changes this time by. McNulty's his replacement as they go for Dylan Goddard. Nevin Sullivan, a huge pick in front. Bergen the shot through the wickets and a goal. Our first goal of the second half, almost halfway through, 9 seconds away from the halfway mark. Here it is, another look. It comes up top. You see the big pick there from Sullivan, and maybe the last defender coming up, perhaps getting in the way. now Farthing Falls. Gets up in time to receive the bounce pass from Cole Murray. Big whack there, Farthing far side. Trying to head to the net was Clover. He gets chopped down in the corner. Riley Campbell, another player, falls in front. As diving Goddard, oh, where's the ball? Big collision there as Kranz came in. Oh, did Kranz intercept that? He's checking the ankle, is Jake Kranz. As that was an awkward collision with Goddard. Somehow Kranz ended up with it. Down in the corner, Goddard again. This time he takes a little bit off it. Trying to fool Wendy. Wendy making the save, picking up the rebound. As McNulty now goes for Wasson, fresh 30. As Zabolks gets it. Quick glance at the clock from Goddard, or pardon me, Wasson, who gives for Goddard. Over the top is McCrory. Zabolts. Hard pressure on him. Coming there from Reed Board. And we've got an interference call, and finally the official's timeout comes here. We've got a couple players bending over, some deep breaths. That was a fast start. Real hard transition effort. We'll see what these teams have in the back half of this quarter. And then we've got one more to play. Final game of the season for the Southwest Cyclops. You're watching C-Lax action from the C-Lax Community Center on C-Lax TV 1. It has been a rough game from the start. We've been documenting that all game long. As looks like that Southwest player still didn't get a number on that play, but hit by his own man, actually. As that chop came. That was at the very start of the third quarter. Took 7 minutes and 21 seconds for Tim Bergen to score a goal. We did check on the lowest scoring quarters. A 1-0 quarter last week up in Barrie. That's happened, I believe, four times was the final determination as McMahon puts the brakes on. He saw the big hit coming from Liam Patton. It's now Jake Kranz down the floor. Patrick Corbett, the shot, and then insult to injury, Cole Murray gets run into by his own man. And Jake Kranz, something's up with that ankle. We saw him try and stretch it out and twisting it a little bit. Heading into the break, he's going to pick up an assist here as he pushes forward. And watch the end there, Cole Murray. Big bear hug from his defender. Give the assist to Jake Kranz. Bit of a painful one, though, as he is now taking a seat on the bench as Rob Clofer stumbles a little bit. Here's Bergen. Over to the wall for Keane. And Keane looks for Bergsma. Going far side now. Bergsma. Bergsma has Keane. Keane, a pick and roll, didn't see Liam Patton or couldn't get the ball through. Shot comes from Keane. Last year, every single one of those would have found its way in. But just struggling mightily this season is Dan Keane. Corbett remains up top. One on him, it's Clofer. Changing a couple players here are the Southwest Cyclops. Patton up for dance. Down into the corner. Corbett hard after it. Clover wins the foot race. Still having Corbett and Dance chase him though. Nevin Sullivan, Jake Kranz back on the floor. He takes it hard into the boards and he's gonna come away with a loose ball win. Here is Kranz. It's over the restraining line, back for center. Played for Braden Curran. Curran, a short flip there for Martin Whitaker. Straight into traffic though. This here's Dan Key and Jordan Dance. Huge bump there, Brett Obikas. Has the ball quickly up over center by Ryan McCrory. McCrory, outside, half boards. He's got Whitaker with him. Back up for Dylan Goddard though. Pick set for Triolo. He continues to back his way down, close to the net. Spins and fires. Trademark shot from Mike Triolo using his size. And interception though, Dylan Goddard scores. Doing his best Chris Atwood impression. Make it 10. 10-6 in favor of the Durham Turf Dogs. What a finish after the interception from Dylan Goddard. Again, 10-6 is the score, and that's the first Turf Dog player to score multiple goals in this game. You think they're sharing the ball. And a shot. Save made by Cole Murray. Straight down the center of the floor for Riley Campbell. Ended up shooting wide though. As McMahon gets all over Gage Board. Board still able to control the ball though. Played into the corner. Couple chops there, jarred free. And every time they can, the Durham Turf Dogs double teaming the ball. As it's a game they're expected to win, but maybe trying to play a bit hard-nosed here as they know the other teams are watching. Should we? They play them in the finals. It looks we've got a penalty coming here. And is it Travis Sabolts? Two for high, sticking is the call. Sabolts will go off. I'm gonna look at it. Yeah, I didn't see one. We heard the bench say it was weak. But it will be a power play here for Southwest as they try and get back in it. Team. For Dance, Dance. Goes into the middle there. Pike. His shot went off nothing as they race back close to the goalie. First one there is Riley Campbell though, just as he arrives on scene. It's touched by Wendy, and the over and back is called. Quick double team here though, as that allows Pike and Keane to get in on the ball. Pike takes the whole pile down, and the ball is gonna roll free. Campbell still in there. He's got help from Brandon Armstrong. Trying to win it with sticks, feet, or anything else, and interference against the Turf Dog player. We saw from our angle, the wrap check may have gone up into the face mask. Joel Furman out of position to make that call. That's the one the bench underneath us wanted. Vredenberg gets taken into the abyss there. Hard into the boards. As the double team's gonna bring the ball out, won by Patrick Corbett. Here comes Corbett, a stutter step. He backs his way to the half boards. Been a cleaning of the shoes going on as Dan Keene has it. Corbett adjusting the stick, now accepts the ball back for Keene. 13 on the clock as number 13 gets it up top. Pike down low, all five have touched it now as Dance goes back for Keene, takes the shot. Murray with the save, and right on the crease is Triolo. That one-handed field style. Jog up over center. Toronto, Kitchener, St. Catharines saw that a lot in junior, as have the Brooklyn Merchants and Redmond. Oh, what a save made by Wendy going to his left. Took a bit of a double clutch there from the forward. But it's still a nice save, having to go all the way across by Craig Wendy. Final minute here as Jordan Dance takes the shot. It's going to be a bounce pass up, trying to lead Nevin Sullivan, was Mark Farthing. And that one bounces long into the corner. Travis Zabolks out of the penalty box. We're back to 5-on-5 lacrosse now. As Wasson has it, shooting around the corner was McMahon. Zabolks is taken down in the crease, picked out by Wendy. As they work down the far side, Southwest still coming in. Zach Sloan, and now a huge bump there. Sloan forced to the outside. Up top, Reed Board, pulling the goaltender now with 15 seconds left in the quarter. Shot clock a non-factor. The game clock is almost 10 seconds to the faster of that. And here's Dan Keen. Oh, fake to the far side. And you hear the horn go just after that ball went in. Dan Keen will have a buzzer beater. That'll make it 10-7 as we head to quarter number four. Nice job getting off coverage. Cole Murray caught cheating there a little bit. As we go to our final break, teams will switch sides one more time. We'll take a timeout. Oof. As we see the physical play. From the start of the game, it has not lessened. What will the final 15 hold? Come back after our timeout. You're watching C-Lax Action on C-Lax TV from Paris, Ontario. Apps Community Center, final time. It's been a long day. Glad to have you with us. Start to finish, our play of the game so far, a diving shot. The first goal of the game from Patrick Corbett, one of our players to watch. 10-7 is the score in favor of the Durham Turfdogs. A win tonight puts them in a tie with the Niagara Lock Monsters, both with one game to play. Oh, that game comes tomorrow. Durham Turf Dogs in Barrie at the Barrie Molson Center. That's a 2 p.m. Eastern time start. C-Lax TV, I believe that is C-Lax TV 2, but we will try and confirm. The other game is the Niagara Lock Monsters Southwest Cyclops, and obviously that'll be on the other C-Lax channel. Before we go off the air, we'll try and confirm that for you, so you know which game to check out. Or you can just drive to that location and come and watch it in person, as it will be Fan Appreciation Day at both arenas, including autograph signings with the entire home teams. Face-off violation against Southwest gives the first possession of the final 15 to the Durham Turfdogs. As Dylan Goddard loses the loose ball battle there to Patrick Corbett. Corbett continues to dance away from Goddard. Corbett down the far side. Goddard with a push. Comes up for Spencer Pike. Pike to the half boards. Dance. Tap dancing his way around. As Keane goes to the far boards. Spinning away there is Graham Bergsman. He takes the shot in on Cole Murray. Murray faked like he was going to touch it, but I think was afraid of the back in call if he did. So instead, just electing to let Dylan Goddard take it down himself. Another save made by Vredenberg, or pardon me, by Wendy on Vredenberg. As he was right on the crease. Craig Wendy having a pretty good game here so far. Despite giving up 10 goals. Here's Dance shooting from the seat of his pants. Couldn't even see the net from where he was from. He just fired it at the top corner. Didn't actually miss by much. As Keane, oh, what a pass over his shoulder. Through a crowd right on what would be the tape, but right in the basket for Sloan. Dance tries to take a shot. That one's off a leg. As it rolls into the corner, up and out of play. Hit nothing on the way by, so it will go for a Durham Turf Dog possession. Vredenberg. Vredenberg will get pushed over the line, but didn't fall. Something's happening underneath of us. Look out here. Monroe on the bench. Jordan Dance is throwing punches as well. Farthing now grabs Jacob Kranz. Main event looked like Jordan Dance and Brandon Monroe. Monroe has been given the gate. We heard some chirping underneath as that play made its way down the floor. Jordan Dance has been sent off, as have Jacob Kranz. Unfortunately, our camera did not catch this, we understand. And this will be interesting, as Monroe's got to make his way in behind the Southwest bench in order to get to his locker room. Grant Spies will escort him the way down. And the yard sale is on underneath of us here. Mark Farthing, the captain, playing peacemaker down there. And we'll see what penalties evolve from that. Tommy Beckett, equipment manager, is involved in the discussion. Our cameras were focused on the play as it made its way down into the turf dog zone. This has always been a topic of conversation down here. This play into the benches, very close to each other down on this side, right underneath of where we are. Here is the tail end of what happened. That's Jordan Dance, Southwest player. Brendan Monroe is the man who he's got. Turf Dog bench was yelling. They said that it was Dance that jumped into their bench. Again, we don't have that on camera, unfortunately. Let's keep your eyes here. And penalties being handed out as Monroe goes, and that's the helmet of Jordan Dance getting returned to the floor at the end of that altercation.
Okay. continue to.
They continue to sort this out down on the floor again. Grant Spies, Neil McDonald, Joel Furman. Kranz and Brandon Monroe get the. Brandon Monroe gets a 5 in a game. Kranz got 5 in a game, I believe was the explanation from Mark Farthing. Bort Dance got 5 in a game, and Monroe got 5 in a game. And then 2 in a game, it sounds like, for Kranz as he came off the bench. The result of this, that is the explanation that we could hear from Mark Farthing after he went from the conversation at the officials' circle when he came over to give it to his bench. As we show you, this is the aftermath again one more time as Monroe has a hold of Dance. Both of them have gone for 5 in a game, and Jacob Kranz came in late. As they had said, he came off the bench. And right at the end, the helmet of Jordan Dance returned to the floor. As things getting interesting inside SILAPS Community Center in Paris, Ontario. Again, 2 games on the schedule tomorrow. We have confirmed Barry Blizzard, Durham Turfdogs. We'll see if they've got the full complement, which will maybe include Brendan Monroe tomorrow. We'll see. That game on C-Lax TV 1, we can confirm that. The Niagara Lock Monsters and Southwest Cyclops on C-Lax TV 2. And of course, if you're in the area, Fan Appreciation Day inside both buildings. Gauge board is past the door now, right next to the border between the benches. So Jordan Dance and Brendan Monroe, their nights finish early, as does Jacob Kranz. It's a power play here for the Durham Turf Dogs as we finally get back underway as play resumes here. Dylan Goddard from the wall. McNulty up top. McMahon, shot comes in, Wendy makes the save and then nods in agreement as he's done that a few times here this evening. Brendan Curran races in. Loose ball there and over and back as that ball came outside the restraining line. So the Turf Dogs get a free possession here. Josh Wasson. Plays it in. Here's Subulks. Oh, in front. That's a pretty goal right there. Walking off the wall. Dylan Goddard has the hat trick, I believe. Power play marker here for the Turf Dogs. Make it 11-7 as the energy with that lengthy delay seems to have been sucked out of the building. And no real big celebration after this one either, as it makes it a 4-goal lead. Wendy all kinds of out of shape. Cody McMahon, the assist. That gives him 1-3. Has someone just been kicked off the Southwest bench? Is it Steve McCarthy, I think? Anyways, they've gone to Looks like Steve McCarthy has been asked to leave, the general manager of the Southwest Cyclops. As we're back to 5-on-5. Some of these boys, someone just said, hurry up, the fights are on. Getting excited for UFC 169. Why look there? Things heating up here in Paris. Who needs Vegas? Here comes Durham. Triolo, 10 seconds on the shot clock now. As they go for Brandon Armstrong, he sent it into the corner. Vredenburg lost the battle with Keane, and then Keane tried to find the cutter. It was Gage Board. After the interception, Vredenburg again overruns a loose ball. Jake Kranz was ejected from this game as he's back on the floor. Thought he was kicked out. That was the explanation from Mark Farthing, but that looks like 17. He falls in the corner. And that's what the question is on the bench underneath of us as well. Unless that's a jersey, but the hair though. Here's Pike. Big collision in the corner. McNulty took his man out. Triolo almost the interception. Now a nice pickup. It's gonna lead the rush. It's a 3-on-2. McNulty takes a big shot. Penalty coming as Patrick McRory beats off the rush to come in and take the shot and score. Again, Kranz is down on the floor. We were told he got the game misconduct. So get another look at the goal. A nice pickup by Triolo. Goes over for McRory, who gets sandwiched as he takes the shot. And we go back to the faceoff. Bergsma, nice win through the legs, straight to Spanger. As Matt Spanger on his wrong side, though, has to circle the net. Up top, Connor Daly from the faceoff dot. I believe that's the free kick spot in the indoor soccer when they play half court. So here comes a shot from Kranz. Doesn't get through. Back here for Curran. Faked like he was going around the corner. Spun back, though. This shot from the far side over top of Cole Murray. Back for Curran again. Still has it. Murray bit on the first shot that didn't arrive. And then Curran did get a second one through as the save is made here. Big hit there as Sullivan went in to take the shot. Here comes Liam Patton down the far side. Kranz with the shot off the shoulder of Murray. As Kranz gets up slowly again, we said he may be a bit banged up as Kranz goes right into the face of Vredenburg. Then Vredenburg falls in the corner. Not sure what happened to him. Him and Kranz were in the vicinity. Looked like Vredenburg just fell. No words from Vredenburg as if there was a penalty. Didn't see anything. Whitaker goes after Bergen, and now the Durham bench wants another call. Again, we're right in the vicinity of the bench as we have a effects mic here to pick up crowd noise and just make it better for you to hear at home. We do apologize if you pick up anything else, including the start of any bench clearing brawls that may start. Be ready for anything when you come to a C-Lax game. Here's Triolo backing down. Only seen that once, though, in the history of the league. It's either good or bad, depending on what side of the bench you're on. Here's Triolo down on the floor, continues to get whacked at. Delayed penalty coming as Triolo went up over the top of the low bridge. And it's against the Southwest Cyclops. Jogging off is Zach Sloan. Eternal. Patrick McRory now has a goal and three assists after the assist on that most recent one. This should be a trip, I think. Yeah, the low bridge. And the score is now 12-7. Cole Murray has been a candidate for three stars every time he's played. In the running again here tonight. Sabolks. Oh, did Wendy make the save there? No, Grant Spies says goal. You can see that ball over the line. Oh my goodness. That would have been one of the saves of the year, as I believe Josh Wasson has the marker this time. Subbolts down to the crease, McNulty, and then just missed the save from Wendy. Number of players with a goal and three assists now for the Durham Turf Dogs. Travis Subbolts joins the club. It's actually Goddard on the assist, his sixth point of the game, as Cole Murray slides over, makes another pretty good save. Hasn't been as spectacular. Here, I think it's the officials' timeout. We'll try and sort some of these penalties out, get you the stats as we get another Evans Dime shout out down on the floor inside the C-Lax Community Center. Back in Paris after this week number 8, C-Lax TV1. You're watching Canadian Lacrosse League action. Back in Paris, once again, a good game for both goaltenders despite the 13 goals against for Craig Wendy. He has been making some spectacular saves. Again, we said, still looking for that full-time playing job. Makes a beautiful one there on Nevin Sullivan, who had to come out with the man right on the doorstep. Let us know who you think the three stars of the game should be. Tweet us, as always, at JVI Video, at C-Lax League. Use the hashtag three stars. As we get set for last call here inside C-Lax Community Center. Closing in on 10 o'clock Eastern time, 13-7. Turf Dogs lead, looking to sit in a tie with the Niagara Lock Monsters for first place overall as we head into the final day of competition here in the regular season. Keane down to the far side. Ball continues to bounce around as Cole Murray finally makes the save. Played up here by Durham now. Off the bench is McMahon. Cody McMahon in the middle. Here's Zebulks. Up top, McMahon. Rolling off the pick was Goss to go up and play defense. Goss comes back to lay out Wasson as he made his way in on net. Good shift there for Blair Goss. Spencer Pike straight down the middle as he tries to pass over for Patrick Corbett. Stolen though as he gets away from Corbett. It's Ryan McRory. Help coming now off the bench. First one there is Dylan Goddard. Now Tim Bergen had his head down as a couple guys came bearing down on him. Shot went through. Wendy saves it, comes back for Corbett. Corbett and Gage board. They said Kranz was gone, but Reed board had picked up the two in the game for unsportsmanlike. As big hit absorbed there by Ryan McCrory, now coughs up the ball. That shot coming from Gage board into the logo of Cole Murray and drops down, which would explain why Gage board was so close to the bench after that little altercation. Here's Zebulks down for Goddard, over the shoulder, trying to get it in on net, and Wendy makes the save and now spins away. Up for Goss now. Blair Goss down into the corner. Back dancing through is Keane. Keane still looking for help. Oh, over the shoulder. What a save off the shoulder of Cole Murray, and it drops down. Murray will now go around the back to dump it into the corner here. Late in the 10 count. Now stopping short of center floor, just lifting it in. And as Cody McMahon runs underneath. Outside shot here from Pike goes in as Murray goes down to play that one. Far side, Matt Spanger. He's got Whitaker coming through. The shot and a goal from Martin Whitaker. First goal since that buzzer beater from Dan Keene at the end of the third quarter with 4 minutes left to play here in regulation time. That one makes it 13-8. As Whitaker just comes straight down the middle after accepting the pass. Jacob Kranz. Again, we thought he had the game misconduct, but apparently it went to Reed board. He was incorrectly identified by Mark Farthing. So Kranz gets it down the wall. McNulty pushes him aside. And as Kranz is just going to dump it into the corner and let the shot clock expire here. McNulty in behind the goalie. Up the far side. Kranz heavy on Nevin Sullivan. 3 minutes left to play as McCrory goes to the far side. Spencer Tangay will have the call tomorrow down in Niagara. If you're in the Barrie region, watch for Stephen Stamp and Ron Ruff on Rogers TV, and of course highlights on CTV News in Barrie following the game, as we will have it for you on C-Lax TV 1 live from the Barrie Molson Center, 2 p.m. Eastern time. Both of those games go split screen, C-Lax TV 1 and 2 on YouTube. And be sure to keep social media open, as you'll want to discuss and keep up to date in real time, as one goal here or there could determine playoff seeding, as Goddard comes down straight in, and Goddard continues to have a fantastic night, making a case early for at least offensive player of the week, if not transition. As that should do it with 2:17 on the clock. That makes it 14-8 here in Paris. Goddard straight down the middle. Pressure can't come fast enough from Patrick Corbett. As he gets in behind Wendy. It's Connor Daly. Low sub shot rises there on Cole Murray. Has great positioning, takes that one into the midsection. As he comes up the near side, the captain, Mark Farthing, puts the brakes on in front of the Southwest bench. He'll run off for a change here. And it's played back for McMahon. Up top. Here comes McMahon, finds, over the shoulder from Bergen. I thought that had gone in, but it's actually over the top of the net. Bounces straight for Jacob Kranz. And Kranz will run it up. Liam Patton with the catch, runs it inside the restraining line now. Number of side steps in for Spencer Pike for taking that shot. Murray with the save. There's a tie up in front between Sloan and somebody, maybe Bergen, as they still get tied up. And the only thing that'll come of that is a interference call. Bergen will stay on, as will Sloan. Now Josh Wasson takes up the fight. Pike, far side, shot from Bergsma, and they score. And nothing more comes of the Sloan versus everybody battle. As it's now a minute and 5 seconds left here in regulation time, 14-9 in favor of Durham. As all attention was being paid on the near side of the floor, that's where Sloan was taking on anybody in green he could find. Neil McDonald, the emphatic early movement call against Graham Bergsma. Gives the ball to Mike Triolo. He's out there to play rag team. As Goddard has it, pushes to the far side. They'll get the big bodies out, looks like, to try and ice this one. As the Durham Turf Dogs will try and clinch first place tomorrow when they travel to Barrie. Again, the Barrie Blizzard still in the hunt if both the Loch Monsters and the Turf Dogs lose tomorrow. The Loch Monsters still in the hunt should they defeat the Cyclops tomorrow. Cyclops looking to play the role of spoiler, but after what happened here this evening, they may have to do it without Jordan Dance. Stay tuned as we await word on whether or not both of these lineups will be at full complements. Again, tonight, no John St. John, no Jesse Guerin, who's still hurt, no Matt Croak, no Derek Hopcroft. So maybe those two guys will be back in. Cole Murray got the start today. It may be Ryan Masters or Lucas Coote, as the rag team was indeed on for the final play. And it is official. The Durham Turf Dogs are tied with the Niagara Loch Monsters atop the C-Lax standings, heading into the final day of competition. Three teams still alive in the hunt for first place, as nothing is decided just yet, as we get set for playoffs next week. The Durham Turf Dogs winning all day here. Midget Turf Dogs picked up gold in the junior game, our third of the day. Fourth game of the day was the Prospects gold medal game, which featured another Durham Turf Dog team winning gold in that division. And now the Durham Turf Dogs here in the pros knock off the home side by a score of 14-9. We take you now to our three stars of the game. And a lot of green on this list. Jeff McNulty, we've named our third star. Officially on the game sheet, credited with one goal and four assists, as he played hard defense as well. Cole Murray, the starting goaltender, a allowing just 9 goals against. He was solid all game long. And Dylan Goddard, our first star of the game, 7 points, 3 goals, 4 assists, already a candidate for one of the Players of the Week awards. Take your pick, transition or offensive player. And he's still got one more to play. That comes your way tomorrow afternoon. One final time, Barry Blizzard will play the Durham Turfdogs at the Barry Molson Center, 2 p.m. Eastern time start. C-Lax TV 1, if you're in the area, get to the BMC early. Dr. Shell sunglasses giveaway inside the BMC. And Niagara Lock Monsters, a fan appreciation day, giveaways down there. Coupons and contests all day as well. That game on C-Lax TV 2. Spencer Tangay will have the call. Our director all day has been Jeremy Hogel. Our producer and camera operator all day has been Gary Morrison. Our thanks to Chad Asseltine for stepping in earlier on behalf of them and our entire JVI Sports Network crew and everyone involved with the Canadian Lacrosse League. I'm Matthew Carrick. Folks, it's been a long one. Get some rest and come back tomorrow when we decide first place in the Canadian Lacrosse League. We will talk to you tomorrow.